I'm here with Dr. Adam Elliott-Cooper from King's College London, researcher at King's College London.
That's correct, yeah, that's
me. I'll upgrade you to lecturer when I feel that you deserve it.
Much appreciated.
And we're here to talk about policing, the criminal justice system, racism, and much more besides. Because last week, figures were released showing that in England and Wales, knife crime has gone up by 21%, which to me seems like an awful lot. So are we really witnessing a new epidemic of violent crime?
I think the figures don't often paint that kind of total picture of moral panic and crisis that we often see in like news studios and the police and politicians' speeches. What we often see is violent crime fluctuating throughout the year. We generally see more violent crime in the summer, less violent crime in the winter, for the simple reason that more people are out in the summer. We sometimes see fluctuations relating to different types of things, whether it be cuts to social services, or whether it be instances of civil unrest, or whether it be other kind of social factors. But I wouldn't say that there is an epidemic that needs the kind of over-the-top reporting that we've seen more recently.
I mean, if you'd believe some of the, particularly the conservative backbenchers were sharing these memes of like, you know, a dripping knife against a, you know, London sky which is stained red, you would think that we were living in some Mad Max Fury Road dystopia.
You would. But I think that's what kind of helps with a lot of this political point scoring, right? So you've got this idea that the Conservative Party, they're the law and order party. So obviously if there's a moral panic around knife crime, if there's a moral panic around terrorism or anything else that requires a stiff law and order approach according to the Conservatives, they're going to jump on top of it quite quickly. And I think we can see that quite a lot, not only with the Conservative Party, but also in the ways in which certain parts of the Labour Party are also capitulating to this kind of law and order kind of governance.
I mean, let's talk more about that. So Sadiq Khan has vowed to step up stop and searches in the capital after having run on a platform of reducing stop and searches. And Jeremy Corbyn, in the summer just gone, had called for Theresa May to resign over policing cuts and has pledged 10,000 extra police officers. So is this, and should it be, the left-wing political response to a rise in violent crime to try and claw back some terrain from that traditional Tory ground of law and order?
I guess there's kind of two ways we can look at this, right? There's a kind of liberal way we can look at it, which is the fact that almost all the evidence suggests that the police don't really prevent crime. Their role is more to, apparently, to solve crimes than to prevent crimes, and they're not too good at that. But even when it comes to preventing crime, there's very little evidence that they prevent crime. The last time we saw a massive influx in stop and search was between 2009 and 2011, and it was an initiative called Operation Blunt 2, which sounds like a bit like an action movie, but it's just an initiative from the Metropolitan Police, where they increased stop and search massively in some inner city boroughs, and increased them a little bit in some other inner city boroughs, and not at all in others. And what they found was that in the boroughs where they increased stop and search loads, it had no effect whatsoever in comparison to the boroughs where they didn't increase stop and search at all. In fact, violent knife crime went up in some boroughs where they increased stop and search, which of course doesn't mean more stop and search leads to more knife crime, but it does mean there's no correlation whatsoever with increasing powers like stop and search and reducing levels of knife crime. And I think the second important thing to note about that is that, of course, this operation took place between 2009 and 2011. It finished in May 2011, and in the August of that year, we saw massive civil unrest, right? And I think that whilst the killing of Mark Duggan probably sparks that unrest, I think that 3 years of intense stop and search by London's Metropolitan Police probably exacerbated the likelihood that we were going to see an explosion like that. So that's a liberal approach, right?
Are you a liberal, Adam?
Not if I can help it. We've also got a radical approach as well, right? And the radical approach is slightly different. And it says that not only is the role of the police not really something that reduces crime, it also reproduces dominant power structures, right? So what do we mean by that? We mean that if you're suspected of handling a gun in Tottenham, you'll probably be arrested. In fact, if you're Mark Duggan, you're executed on the spot without anyone asking any questions. But if you sell F-16s to Saudi Arabia or Israel, you'll probably get an OBE. Right? This is the role of the police. If you're suspected of smoking a spliff on Brixton High Street, you can expect to be stopped by the police. But if you sell highly addictive antidepressants through the pharmaceutical markets, you're a pillar of British industry, right? If you, there are mothers who were given custodial sentences for handling stolen goods which were appropriated during the unrest of 2011. But if you invade Iraq, cancel all oil contracts, write new oil contracts of your multinational oil companies, and kill a million odd people, you'll be made Middle East peace envoy, right? So there's this, the role of the police isn't just a failure in terms of their capacity to reduce what we consider to be crime. It's also the fact that they are there to police poorer people, to police working class communities, particularly communities of colour, and reproduce the power of the state, reproduce the power of capital.
So let's go into this with a bit more depth, because there are some viewers who will hear that and go, well, obviously, under a Conservative government, the role of the police is to protect the interests of the ruling class. Mm. But when Comrade Jezza gets in, obviously that all changes. We will have a more just policing system. So how do you respond to that? What's useful to think about? What historical moments is it useful to think about in terms of critiquing that vision of the police?
Okay, so there's two things. As I already said, there's this problem with the way in which crime is socially constructed, right? There's certain, there are comparable types of crime which are criminalised and which aren't criminalised. That's the first thing. But secondly, even if we think about the history of policing and the history of crime, they're intrinsically bound up with class and race. So let's take stop and search, example we've already discussed a little bit. We first see stop and search emerge, I think, around 1829 with what's called the Vagrancy Act, where legislated identified what they called perpetual criminals among Britain's working classes. And this was debated in Parliament and it was thrown out because they said, we can't have this Vagrancy Act. You know, we can't say there are perpetual criminals that can be stopped and searched just because they have this intrinsic capacity for crime. This goes against British civil liberties and the British rule of law and all that kind of stuff. So they threw it out. But what Britain did was, and a lot of people often forget this, was that Britain, the island of Britain, wasn't the only place being policed by Britain at this time. It had many colonies. And its colonies, it continued using variations of the Vagrancy Act, whether it be the Criminal Tribes Act in India, or whether it be the ways in which anti-terror legislation was used in Kenya, or whether it be the ways in which legislation relating to riots, civil unrest and trade union organising was used in the Caribbean. We can see that things relating to not requiring reasonable suspicion or allaying suspicion at the hands of the police is an integral part of policing. And that kind of policing is always, it was explicitly focused on the working class, the perpetual criminals or colonised communities in Britain's colonies. And now we see that reproduced here in Britain without those kind of explicit classist and racist labels, but still basically doing the same thing. So there's something very intrinsic, I think, when it comes to racism and capitalism and the police that I think we have to recognise when we try to reform these kinds of institutions.
Because I think that there's sometimes a problem with how we frame anti-racist discourse, which is we characterise racism as just a numbers game. So when we talk about uneven implementation of stop and search, the implicit assumption there is that, well, it would be better if it just more accurately reflected the ethnic makeup of the population. So 14% of stop and search are POC, the rest are white. Whereas you're talking much more about, the raison d'etre of the police force in the first place. And in terms of meeting that structural critique, in the United States, you do have a very strong prison abolitionist tradition. It might not be hegemonic politically, but it certainly exists, and there is a strong cultural memory of that. In this country, it seems to me that we've got anti-racist movements, many of which have been forgotten. We've got a anti-racism of institutions, which I think was very successfully co-opted and institutionalised post-Scarman report, really. And you have an abolitionist tradition, but these three things don't normally link up. So what is Britain's abolitionist tradition? Does it have one? And if so, can we bring it back?
I think what's one of the benefits for the left in Britain that I think is often forgotten is that Britain's leftist tradition doesn't simply reside within the British mainland, right? Britain has a strong leftist tradition which emerged in its colonies, which were part of Britain in many, many ways. And these colonies have a very strong, very interesting abolitionist history. To give one example, the history of Trinidad, in its anti-colonial struggles, which are of course against the British state and the British imperial state, the legacies of this in the 1970s in its Black Power movement emerged through a distinctly abolitionist guys. You've got organisations like the NUFF, the National United Freedom Front, which were explicitly anti-police and explicitly anti-prison. And they understood that despite the fact that Trinidad formally had its independence from Britain, there was still a neo-colonial relationship between Britain and its former colonies, which was rooted in racism and was imposed through the penal system, through the justice system, through the policing, the courts and the prisons, etc. And so I think the fact that so many prominent black British or British leftist activists against policing, when we think about Dark as Hell, when we think about others like that, we realise that there is a strong anti-police and anti-prison tradition in Britain if we are to look beyond Britain's borders and within its empire, which I think has played a pivotal role in developing British culture generally, including its anti-establishment traditions.
So what alternatives to a carceral model of criminal justice are out there? What do abolitionist reforms look like?
So again, there's kind of two approaches, right? You've kind of got this liberal approach and a more radical one. And the liberal approach is one that I guess people have been pushing for with Jeremy Corbyn, right? Because, you know, we can't abolish prisons tomorrow. We need to do a lot more transforming. And this looks like what we might call preventative or early intervention services. So things like youth services, right? We've seen over 600 youth clubs close. We've seen over 3,500 youth workers lose their jobs. Hundreds of thousands of young people are no longer being able to access the kind of services that they benefit from. So that's one thing. Or social work, where you have intervention into families and family feuds and victims and survivors of domestic violence and so on and so forth, as well as mental health services, right? It's not any secret that a huge proportion of the people inside our prison system are suffering with mental health issues. And so these kinds of already existing welfarist institutions can be a really important way of reducing crime, making the country a safer place for everyone, and importantly, reducing prison numbers, reducing people in custody, reducing people who are being policed in a more violent way. And you can see these kinds of models in, you know, the lovely utopian places of Northern Europe, which often people on the left can refer to as well. But there's a more kind of liberatory politics as well, which identifies the fact that policing and the prison system is fundamental to capitalism. Right? It's fundamental to the protection of property. It's fundamental for the bourgeoisie to control the means of production. And so if we think about the fact that capital cannot exist without the state and capital cannot exist without the police and prisons in order to, number one, legitimise its very existence and it's the property which it owns, but secondly, to protect it when people try to disrupt or appropriate the means of that production. We understand that the police and prisons are fundamentally opposed to the will of ordinary people. They're fundamentally opposed to any anti-capitalist struggle. And therefore, it is incumbent upon us on the left to understand that if we want to abolish things like private property, we want to abolish wage labour, all of these things that seem to be the bread and butter of the left, we also have to abolish police and prisons as well.
I mean, and it seems to me that there is a populist phrasing which has just kind of emerged naturally from how you phrase that. Normally we think the populist demand is just, more Keynesianism for institutional racism, whereas actually the language that you're using of ordinary people, of people against profit, that does lend itself to abolitionism and I think is underexplored. But I've got one last question for you. So, a snap election is called tomorrow, and everyone's like, shit, we've got to write another manifesto. And you get called upon to suggest one policing-related policy in that Labour manifesto.
Oh, dear.
What would it be?
Oh, dear. It's a very difficult question, isn't it? It's a very difficult question.
That's why I put you on the spot.
Because my immediate response through the kind of activist work that I've been involved in relation to deaths in police custody and police engaged in racial violence. The kind of demands that you see there are always demands for greater transparency, for greater accountability, right? So having a genuinely independent body that can scrutinise senior officers, not your bobbies on the beat, for making specific decisions about specific policies and practices which lead to deaths, which lead to an increased arrest rates and other forms of violence. So that is the thing that kind of jumps out at me, because this is a demand that's often perpetuated, often reproduced, I guess, through a lot of the anti-racist organising that I'm familiar with. But it's difficult to say how much of a change that's really going to bring about. And I guess what I feel more inclined to suggest would be for the police to reframe the way in which crime is prioritised, right? So they have certain priority crimes and certain crimes that are not considered to be priorities. So priority crimes are raiding people who are supposed to be selling class A drugs like ecstasy and cocaine, which, you know, of course, are so evil. Priority crimes are supposed to be, you know, the street level gang crimes that are supposed to be priority crimes. But I think maybe we should instead prioritise corporate crimes. Maybe we should prioritise the fact that we have massive corruption in relation to things like privatisation and the dodging of tax and the selling of weapons to despotic regimes and the funding of war. All of these things I think should and can be considered crimes, and they should be priority crimes. And maybe the police should switch their priority crimes to these corporate and state crimes rather than the apparent crimes of ordinary people.
So it's more go for Carillion, leave Don Corleone alone.
100.
Cool. Thank you so much for joining us. Hopefully that's been useful and instructive for our viewers, and we can't wait to get you on again.
Thanks so much for having me.
Cheers. Appreciate it.